So, folks, one of the more disturbing things that we've seen when it comes to old Donnie isn't simply that he's a ghoul, isn't simply that he's done awful things, but that when anyone investigates him, he attacks them personally. And we've seen that with every single prosecutor that's gone at Trump. But one thing we have noticed is that at times, like with Jack, he's also attacked family. He's also attacked their friends and their acquaintances. And that's the direction we've headed in tonight with how he's approaching Alvin Bragg, because his next attacks indicate that there is nothing he won't do and there is no one in Bragg's life he won't threaten very, very violently if it helps save him. And as people are noting, this is a sociopathic monster whose rally over the weekend and all of that indicates a man that's nowhere near his threshold for violence. Listen to this call about Trump being a sociopath.
I'd like to stay with you for just a second. You mentioned that all the different cases, there's so many investigations swirling around the former president right now. But he came out, he said that in this one in Manhattan, the Manhattan DA's potential case against him or the potential indictment against him, he thought he'd be arrested last Tuesday. That never came to be, but yet we talked about it for a whole week. He was able to go to Waco, Texas and say that he was a victim, that he's being persecuted. Is this just another example of him kind of playing everything to his strengths, inserting himself back into the conversation? And how do you think he continues to deal with that moving forward in this race?
So I don't give Trump that much credit of being this genius that's able to manipulate everyone around him and take these moments and utilize them to his advantage. I think that he's a sociopath. And I think that what you're starting to see is that behavior as he has his back against the wall. You know, I'm not sure how strong the case is in Manhattan. But again, no one man is above the law. But I think that as the pressure begins to squeeze Donald Trump, his back gets against the wall. With that type of psychopathy, no telling what this man may do.
Look, I'm not a doctor. Neither is he. So I don't know if you could technically diagnose him with sociopathy, but in a colloquial sense, yeah, this man's an absolute sociopath, and he's always been. A total lack of empathy, just an awful person, just, you know, immoral, amoral, whatever you want to call it, evil, probably. But, like, this is a man that has no regard for human life except his own. So, of course, he's going to be the kind of person that if he feels he needs to, he will use violence or the threat of violence or mobilize violence to achieve his objectives. And none of this is a coincidence. Like, it's not a coincidence that he's facing indictment, you know, whether it comes now or as we might note, we might talk about later tonight, it might be delayed a bit, but whether he faces indictment, you know, today or in the next coming weeks, he wants to use his movement to intimidate people. And even some of the people in some Trump observers who have been criticized for being soft on Trump acknowledge that.
Caitlin, I want to start with you. You have been to so many of Trump's rallies. You are all too familiar with his inflammatory rhetoric and his ways. And, you know, when you look at this versus 2016, in 2016, his messages were often dark, talking about carnage in America. This seems more extreme. What do you think?
I think the way I'm looking at it is how he campaigned in 2020. And on that, a lot of that was focused on his election grievances. What it seems to be focused now on in this Waco rally was his investigation grievances and the issues with his investigations, because that was something he centered on. He talked about the weaponization of the Justice Department, saying that was the central issue of our time, is I think how he referred to it. And obviously, you know, when you poll voters, those are not the top issues that they have concerns about. Maybe some Trump supporters do, but generally Republican voters, that's not the top of their list. And so it was just notable to me that that was kind of his central message, is the investigations he's focusing or that he's facing, the legal peril that he is in. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of the message that he was driving home. Now, on the flip side of that, I will say there were a lot of people at this rally. There was a lot of enthusiasm at this rally. So I think that is an important thing to note when the reporters are there on the ground, when we talk about and you hear from people like Chris Christie, who just said tonight in an interview with Axios that because, you know, the January 6th choir was playing at the beginning of that rally, he says he can't, that person shouldn't be president, that he's not going to support Trump again for the presidency. That's a notable comment from people like Chris Christie, but does it match up with the Republican primary base? That's obviously an open question.
Yeah, what do you think, Maggie?
Yeah, look, I do think it's pretty striking that, number one, he was airing that footage at all, that it was hand to heart with this chorus. January 6th is an issue that Donald Trump was trying to avoid talking about for a very long time after he left office, because it was a terrible day. And I understand that there has been an effort to try to, you know, reimagine what took place, but it was a terrible day. And so to go from that in 2021 to now openly embracing it, simultaneous with this intimidation campaign that he's running against the Manhattan District Attorney, I don't think I can take these things as separate. But I agree with Caitlin, there's a market for it. His base is clearly supporting this. His base likes it. You know, as much as I think that it doesn't discourage Alvin Bragg from potentially prosecuting Donald Trump just because of these attacks, and it actually could help Bragg politically, it also helps Trump politically. And I think that is, you know, as long as there is a market for something, Donald Trump is going to push it.
Yeah. And he feeds off the crowd. He was bragging about the song, how it was number one on iTunes here.
So many people have noted to me that Haberman is, some people feel she's too much of a stenographer for Trump, like she just kind of repeats his things. But here she actually goes out and says, like, it's not a coincidence that you have the Waco rally and the calls for violence and the death and destruction and his personal attacks on Bragg. Like, none of this is a coincidence. This is a man that's weaponizing things. And we're going to talk about, he puts out a couple other statements today where he's demanding full-on war against Alvin Bragg. And he's basically saying there's nothing he won't do to stop Alvin Bragg. And what that means is, and nothing's off limit. No one's off limit. Nothing is off limit. And this is also connected to his growing paranoia. Remember, when Trump gets paranoid, he's very dangerous. And it's not just the Bragg case that's setting off the paranoia. But as we've noted, when Trump is paranoid in one venue, it leaks into others. This is why, for example, his attacks on Bragg have affected other investigations and how judges are approaching them. And for example, right now, this, you know, federal investigation with all the new aides that are being forced to testify has Trump feeling like a mob boss where everyone's going to flip on him.
What we could all see with our own eyes, right? Clear evidence of a felony. You now have a second judge ruling that the reason Pence can testify is because of Donald Trump's illegality. Mueller years and years ago said, if I could say that Trump hadn't committed crimes, I would have. You have in the sentencing memo for Michael Cohen that Donald Trump, based on SDNY's investigation, directed and coordinated a campaign finance violation fraud. I wonder, in your view, what the stakes are at this point for all of the illegality that people in Congress and the judiciary have said Donald Trump has committed to actually have a consequence.
Well, it seems quite evident that the former president likely committed a crime. That's not just idle speculation. As you note, Nicole, several judges have now made that suggestion that the former president may have engaged in criminal acts, and that's why they're making these extraordinary orders for these officials to testify. And so I think that much is clear. But this also drives us back to the basics when it comes to an investigation. That being, once these individuals come in to testify, they're going to be driven by a very simple human motivation, which is to keep themselves out of jail. And that's ultimately how you get a lot of the testimony you need to make a case against someone like this, someone like Donald Trump, is you need to convince his subordinates that they have the option to cooperate and to save their lives and careers, or they have the option to obstruct and potentially face those investigations and those consequences themselves. So it's like a classic mob case. They're going to get some of these people to flip. I feel very confident that once all of their legal remedies are exhausted and they've gone to every judge they can to try to prevent themselves from testifying, that they ultimately will testify. And a number of them will testify against their former boss because they want to have careers in presidential politics. Some of them, like Mike Pence, want to be deemed credible to run for the presidency of the United States. And that's going to require them to not be in a jail cell. So I think you're going to see those basic human motivations come into play as these individuals, again, exhaust their remedies.
So, Harry, I hate turning these conversations into...
This is the context where a dangerous man becomes that much more dangerous to everyone, to his cronies, but also to the cops and also to the prosecutors looking down on him. And what he just tweeted earlier today went really in that direction. And there's another one as well. But what he said through his retweeting on True Social or whatnot is that it's time for war. And it says here, Trump has been stoking a firestorm ever since reports emerged that various law enforcement agencies would be meeting with Manhattan District Attorney Alvin Bragg's office to prepare for a possible indictment and arrest of Trump in Bragg's probe over the hush money payments. On Tuesday night, Trump threw some more fuel on the fire with a post on his True Social platform in which he posted a screed from Trump supporter Wayne Allen Root, entitled "Democrats want to indict and arrest President Trump. They want a war. Let's give it to them." And you see it here. And in essence, what he's basically saying is we should retaliate. We should go after everyone who's an enemy of Trump. We should basically make them regret the day that they looked into Donald Trump. And that is terrifying. And this one notes it as well, where it's funny in a sense, but it's still pretty dangerous.
So let's turn to another big story that's out. Of course, we're all watching. I'm here in Manhattan right now. We're watching what the grand jury is going to do. They're examining Donald Trump's role in the hush money payment scheme with adult performer Stormy Daniels that is set to break for most of April. A source tells CNN, Trump praised the grand jury, as we know, on True Social this morning, writing, quote, "I have gained such respect for this grand jury and perhaps even the grand jury system as a whole. The evidence is so overwhelming in my favor and so ridiculously bad for the highly partisan and hateful district attorney." Van, how do you interpret that?
Well, when they indict him, I don't think he's going to be saying the same thing. So, you know, basically today, Trump tries to manage his emotions moment to moment. So he's feeling good about what seems to be a delay. But let's not forget, he was the one who said he was going to be arrested a week ago or whenever it was. And so there's no delay except in the false timeline he created. Grand juries take as long as they take. Those of us who are part of this business know that they take the time that they take, and we'll see.
So he's calling it like a sick investigation, and he sees the delay as like some kind of victory for himself, when it really isn't. Yeah, the delay, of course, isn't ideal if you wanted to see it happen now, if you're impatient, but it could be more administrative. There's a bunch of holidays coming up, both Christian and Jewish and other holidays, that kind of necessitate a break anyway, and so you might as well take one now. But this is a man who's making these threats. And these are the exact same ways that he threatened Jack, not just Jack himself, but when he went in at his wife. And I really think that's what he's doing here. He's not just attacking Bragg, he's attacking everyone that Bragg is responsible for. And that's the only way you get to someone like Alvin, I think. Because, you know, ultimately, he's not concerned about himself, but I bet he is concerned about the people that work under him and his family. And Donald Trump being the monster that he is, he's already threatened other people's wives. I think that's where this is heading as well.